Before dinosaurs ruled the earth, before birds took to the skies, there was another reign, a time when insects weren't just pests. They were predators, giants, masters of a world thick with oxygen and teeming with life. Welcome to the Carboniferous period, where dragonflies were bigger than seagulls, millipedes stretched like buses, and scorpions hunted on land and in water. In this video, we'll discuss the forces behind their massive size, the alien world they ruled, and what ultimately brought their golden age to an end. This is the story of how far evolution can go when the rules of the planet change. To understand why giant insects thrived during the Carboniferous period, we have to understand the world they lived in, because it was profoundly different from our own. The Carboniferous lasted from roughly 359 to 299 million years ago, nestled between the Devonian and Permian periods. The continents we know today didn't exist yet in anything like their modern form. Instead, most land masses were gathered into two immense supercontinents, Gondwana in the south and Laurasia in the north. These titanic land masses were slowly drifting toward each other, pulled by tectonic forces that would eventually assemble the supercontinent Pangaea. During the Carboniferous, much of present-day North America and Europe lay near the equator, blanketed in dense tropical swamp forests. These forests lacked flowers, grasses, or pines. Instead, towering lycopods like Lepidodendron, over 100 feet tall with hollow pith-filled trunks and giant horsetails, dominated. Beneath them, ferns and seed ferns formed a tangled, humid understory, creating a warm, wet, and shadowy world. This unique environment had a dramatic effect on the atmosphere. The rampant plant growth, combined with limited decomposition in the anoxic swampy soils, led to massive burial of organic carbon. That burial reduced the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere and led to a corresponding spike in oxygen. By some estimates, atmospheric oxygen during the Carboniferous peaked at around 35%, far higher than today's 21%. This was no trivial difference. Higher oxygen levels don't just affect fire risk or breathing, they alter the entire physiology of life, particularly in organisms that rely on passive respiration. Insects and other arthropods, for instance, breathe through spiracles, tiny holes in their exoskeletons connected to a network of internal tubes called trachea. These trachea deliver oxygen directly to tissues without the use of lungs or blood to carry it. In modern insects, this system works well at small scales, but becomes increasingly inefficient as body size increases. But in a world where oxygen was more abundant and diffused more readily, the constraints that normally limit insect size were loosened. The Carboniferous atmosphere essentially supercharged their ability to grow. And these weren't just large insects in isolation, they were dominant. Insects had already made the leap to land in earlier periods, but by the Carboniferous, they had fully established themselves in terrestrial ecosystems. Some, like the primitive Paleodictyoptera, had already evolved wings, making insects among the first animals to conquer the skies. On land, arthropods filled roles as predators, scavengers, and herbivores. Giant millipedes, early scorpions, and a wide array of winged and wingless species scuttled through the undergrowth and filled the forest canopy. Meanwhile, vertebrates were only just beginning to find their footing. Amphibians, some of them quite large, inhabited the swamps and river margins, and the earliest reptiles, egg layers better suited to drier conditions, were just starting to appear. But dinosaurs were still over 100 million years away. In this world, the arthropods had little competition from the vertebrate realm, particularly in the air. They were the undisputed lords of their niches. This period produced some of the most extraordinary creatures to ever crawl or fly across the earth. No creature better symbolizes Carboniferous gigantism than Meganeura, a colossal dragonfly-like insect whose fossilized wings can span up to 70 centimeters, roughly 2.3 feet. That's larger than most modern birds of prey. But Meganeura wasn't a bird, nor a dragonfly in the modern sense. It belonged to an extinct group of insects called the griffinflies, close relatives to today's dragonflies and damselflies, but structurally distinct in several key ways. Meganeura was a pure predator. Its head featured powerful mandibles and large, multifaceted eyes capable of detecting even the slightest movement. Like modern dragonflies, it likely hunted while in flight, snatching prey from the air using spiny legs and devouring it on the wing. Its diet would have included smaller insects, possibly even juvenile amphibians or other arthropods. Nothing else could match it in the air. The mechanics of its flight are part of its evolutionary fascination. Unlike birds or bats, which use muscular flapping through jointed limbs, insects like Meganeura flew by rapidly oscillating wings attached directly to their thorax via muscles. This indirect flight mechanism allowed incredibly fast wing beats and agile maneuverability. Meganeura possessed two pairs of wings that could beat out of phase, an adaptation that gave it stability and precision in complex aerial environments. Fossil evidence shows these wings were strengthened with thick veins and nodal flexion points, suggesting they were well adapted to support the stress of high-speed flight at large size. However, such large size in a flying insect would be all but impossible today. Modern air density, combined with 21% oxygen levels, limits even the most efficient insect flyers to wingspans of just a few inches. Meganeura's very existence points directly to the supercharged oxygen environment of the Carboniferous, and perhaps also to the absence of vertebrate competition in the skies. It ruled the air not because it outcompeted birds, but because there were no birds to begin with. If Meganeura dominated the skies, then Arthropleura was the uncontested monarch of the forest floor. This creature, a distant relative of today's millipedes and centipedes, could grow longer than 2.5 meters, nearly the length of a small car. Its body was segmented, armored, and low-slung, undulating across the leaf litter on dozens of legs in coordinated waves of motion. Fossil trackways show it moved with surprising grace for something so massive and armored. Despite its fearsome appearance, Arthropleura was a herbivore. It likely grazed on decomposing plant matter, ferns, and soft stems, scraping food into its mouth using mandibles suited for grinding rather than piercing or slicing. Yet its size and appearance would have made it a formidable presence. Few predators of the time could threaten such a heavily armored and enormous invertebrate. Its sheer bulk and exoskeletal plating likely made it functionally immune to attack. Arthropleura fossils have been discovered across Europe and North America, indicating it was widespread during the late Carboniferous. Its size was made possible not just by oxygen saturation, but also by the lack of large terrestrial predators. With the forest floors densely packed with detritus and soft plants, it found a buffet and almost no competition for it. Interestingly, Arthropleura is one of the largest known land-dwelling invertebrates in Earth's history. And yet, unlike many of its contemporaries, it left behind no descendants. Its lineage eventually died out, likely as drier climates and new competitors, especially reptiles, emerged. But while it thrived, it was a walking fortress in a swampy world. Among the most unsettling inhabitants of the Carboniferous was Pulmonoscorpius, a giant scorpion that grew up to 70 centimeters in length, nearly three times the size of today's largest scorpions. Its fossils, found primarily in Scotland, suggest it was a formidable ambush predator. Like modern scorpions, it possessed large pincers and a curved tail ending in a venomous stinger. What sets Pulmonoscorpius apart is not just its size, but its ecological role. It likely straddled two worlds, the terrestrial and the aquatic. Many researchers believe it was amphibious, capable of foraging both on land and in shallow waters, much like some crabs or amphibious fish today. Its anatomy supports this. Well-developed walking legs, evidence of book lungs for terrestrial respiration, and a thick exoskeleton that could resist both desiccation and predatory attacks. Was it venomous? While we don't have preserved venom glands, the presence of a prominent stinger and similarities to modern scorpions strongly suggest it was. Its prey likely included small arthropods, insect larvae, and perhaps even the soft-bodied juveniles of early vertebrates. Its success, however, was likely limited by its own physiology. Like other large arthropods, it relied on passive oxygen diffusion, which imposed constraints on its metabolic rate and activity levels. Pulmonoscorpius stands as an example of early arthropod predation at scale, a land-based carnivore that required no bones or warm blood to become a terror of its time. Beyond these headline creatures were numerous other oversized arthropods that thrived in the Carboniferous. Giant cockroach-like insects, some over 10 centimeters long, filled detritivore niches. These weren't just scaled-up pests. They were essential recyclers in an ecosystem where fallen plant matter accumulated quickly. Their flattened bodies and long antennae made them perfectly suited for navigating the leaf litter and decaying wood. Then there were the early spiders. Though technically not insects, they belonged to the broader arthropod phylum. These arachnids hadn't yet evolved the complex web structures of modern orb weavers, but they were already formidable ground-dwelling predators. Their size ranged up to 20 centimeters in leg span. They likely hunted using ambush techniques, relying on speed and venom to subdue prey. Tiktaalik and other tetrapods, early vertebrates making the transition from water to land, shared these habitats but occupied a different evolutionary space. While not arthropods, they represent the vertebrate frontier slowly pushing into terrestrial ecosystems. At this time, however, they posed little threat to the invertebrate giants. The largest land vertebrates of the period were still small, slow, and heavily tied to aquatic environments. But these forest-dwelling giants weren't the only massive creatures to come from the arthropod family tree. In fact, some of their evolutionary cousins reached even more astonishing sizes, not in the swamps, but beneath the surface of ancient seas. Roughly 30 million years before Meganeura ever took flight, the oceans were ruled by an absolute unit of a predator, Jecalopterus renaniae, the largest arthropod ever discovered. This was no shrimp. At an estimated 2.5 meters long, that's over 8 feet. Jecalopterus looked like a cross between a lobster, a scorpion, and a nightmare. It was part of an extinct group called Eurypterids, also known as sea scorpions, though they're not true scorpions as we know them, with massive clawed pincers and a long segmented body that could propel it through shallow waters. Jecalopterus was likely an apex predator in its time, hunting armored fish and other invertebrates in murky freshwater estuaries. You might wonder, if the Carboniferous giants we met earlier needed high oxygen and warm, wet forests to reach their sizes, how did creatures like Jecalopterus get so big in water? The answer lies in physics. In the ocean, and even in freshwater, buoyancy provides a natural counter to gravity. That means heavy exoskeletons don't collapse under their own weight as easily as they do on land. Movement is easier. Structures can be bigger, bolder, more ambitious. And during much of the Paleozoic era, aquatic oxygen levels were also relatively high, enough to fuel larger body plans. The seas were teeming with early life, from jawless fish to trilobites, offering a buffet for predators like Jecalopterus. So while a forest dragonfly the size of a hawk is amazing, a swimming scorpion the size of a kayak, that's a different kind of terrifying. The marine world wasn't the only place arthropods pushed boundaries. Take trilobites, for example. Those armored, many-legged creatures that crawled across the seafloor for over 250 million years. Most were small, but some grew as long as a loaf of bread. Or consider horseshoe crabs, distant cousins of spiders that first appeared during the Ordovician. They've barely changed in 450 million years, and though they never reached enormous sizes, they're living fossils, remnants of a world when arthropods experimented with scale on a massive level. No single explanation for Carboniferous arthropod gigantism is sufficient on its own. It wasn't just oxygen, or the absence of predators, or lush environments. It was all of these, converging over tens of millions of years. The planet itself created a crucible in which evolutionary constraints were lifted, and organisms responded in kind. This is what makes the Carboniferous so fascinating. It shows us not just how life adapts, but how it transforms when given entirely new parameters. When the climate shifted, when oxygen levels dropped, and when new vertebrate predators emerged, the era of giants came to an end. But for a brief geological moment, evolution showed us what invertebrate life was capable of under different rules. It gave us giants, not monsters, but optimized products of a world that for a time belonged to them. The reign of the giant arthropods did not end with a single catastrophe. There was no asteroid, no sudden extinction event to wipe them from the swamps and skies. Instead, their decline unfolded gradually, shaped by a cascade of environmental changes, evolutionary pressures, and biological limitations. The world that had once enabled insect gigantism was steadily dismantled by forces that were invisible yet relentless. As the Carboniferous period gave way to the Permian, the conditions that had allowed giant arthropods to thrive were replaced by ones that made their survival, and especially their size, impossible. The most fundamental shift was atmospheric. Near the end of the Carboniferous, oxygen levels began to fall dramatically, from a high of roughly 35% to near modern levels around 21%. This collapse in oxygen concentration was not a random fluctuation. It had a clear cause rooted in biological innovation, the evolution of wood-decaying fungi. For millions of years, dead plant matter, especially lignin-rich trees, had piled up in massive peat beds, locking away carbon and driving up oxygen through the unchecked photosynthesis of vast forests. But once fungi evolved the enzymatic machinery to break down lignin, that organic material was no longer buried, but decomposed, returning carbon dioxide to the atmosphere and reducing oxygen production. The biosphere's balance shifted. This change had immediate consequences for arthropods. As we've seen, their respiratory systems depend on the passive diffusion of oxygen through tracheae. In an atmosphere rich in oxygen, even large insects could deliver enough oxygen to their tissues. But as oxygen levels dropped, the upper limit on viable body size shrank. Gigantism became a liability. Insects that had once thrived in the high oxygen world found themselves physiologically constrained. Fossil records reflect this. Giant forms disappear or become rare. And by the Permian, most insects are within modern size ranges. At the same time, the evolutionary landscape was shifting in another critical way. Vertebrates were rising. Reptiles began to diversify and radiate into new niches. These early amniotes, capable of laying eggs on land and living in drier environments than amphibians, became increasingly dominant. As predators, they presented a new threat to arthropods, one they had never faced during their golden age. On land, reptiles could pursue, capture, and consume even large invertebrates. In the air, things changed even more dramatically during the Permian, and especially the Mesozoic, when pterosaurs and eventually birds evolved. These vertebrate flyers redefined aerial ecosystems. They were faster, more agile, and more metabolically efficient than insects. They competed directly for the skies, and ultimately won. With their emergence, the large flying insects of earlier ages were permanently outclassed. The climate was changing too. Late in the Carboniferous, the Earth entered a prolonged ice age. Massive glaciations gripped southern Gondwana, triggering a global cooling trend. The warm, humid swamps that had once covered the equatorial regions began to shrink, replaced by drier, more seasonal environments. The great forests fragmented. Waterlogged peatlands gave way to more open, arid terrain. For creatures like Arthropleura, which depended on constant humidity and abundant decaying plant matter, these changes were devastating. As their habitats disappeared, so did they. Giant insects once ruled Earth during the Carboniferous period, thriving in a world with high oxygen, lush swamp forests, and little vertebrate competition. Dragonflies the size of hawks, and millipedes longer than a car weren't fantasy. They were the product of unique atmospheric and ecological conditions. But as oxygen levels dropped, climates dried, and reptiles rose, those giants disappeared. Their story is a reminder that evolution is shaped by the world around it. Life expands when the environment allows, and contracts when it doesn't. Though today's insects are smaller, they carry the legacy of that ancient age. The fossils remain, telling us what life once was, and what it can be under different skies.